Jesus said, I'm the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, or she may die, yet shall she live. And whoever lives and believes in me never really dies. Do you believe this? And then from the book of Revelation, Jesus said, I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. What you see, write in a book and send it to the church. Do not be afraid. I am the first and the last. I am he who lives, who was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. Heavenly Father, we come into your presence today to say our human goodbye to our departed loved one and our friend and loved one family, Nancy Clampy. Lord, our hearts ache today in her absence, and yet we are overjoyed that she has finished the race that you have set out for her to run. And so, Lord, I pray that you would bless now this family and these friends who have gathered in this place. Let this day be a day that we can acknowledge where what all of us already know, life is good, but we do not want to be on this earth in a state that is not good. And that's where Nancy was headed. It was not going to be good if she was kept here. So far better for her to go and for us now to pine to be where she is. Help us today as we consider all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Nancy Carol Clampy of Moravia, Iowa, died on May 5th, 2022, at the ripe age of 78. Amen. Nancy was born on August 18th, 1943, in Albia, Iowa, to Dallas and Nina Griffin Faber. She lived most of her life in and around Moravia. In a short time in Oskaloosa, Iowa, Jackson, Kentucky, and Keokuk, Iowa. She graduated from Moravia High School with her classmates of 1961. Nancy married John Russell of Oskaloosa, and to this union was born one daughter, Susan Carol Russell. On April 24, 1965, she married Donald R. Clampy. She was a stay-at-home mom for several years before being employed as a cook at the Albia Manor, and then for 19 years as the school cook at the Moravia Community Schools. She was also a cook at Mount Carmel Christian School in Van Cleve, Kentucky, and Kirksville Bible School in Kirksville, Missouri. I guess you could say the lady liked to cook. Amen? Amen. She was a longtime member here at Lighthouse Church of the Nazarene in Moravia, where she taught Sunday school for many years, as well as being the missionary president. She loved cooking for her family. There it is again. Reading jigsaw puzzles and writing a column in the Moravia paper. And if you ever missed a detail of her life, it's not because she didn't tell you on Facebook. Amen. Nancy is survived by her stepsons, Roderick Clampy of Altoona, Iowa, Robert Clampy of Mooresville, Indiana, James Clampy of Altoona, Iowa, her daughter Susan Ronnie Welch of Moulton, Iowa, along with several grandchildren and great-grandchildren that she also loved to talk about all of the time. She has a brother, Robert and Rose Faber of Moravia, Iowa, and a sister, Norma Martin, of Moravia, Iowa as well. She was preceded in death by her husband, Donald Clampy, her parents, Dallas and Nina Faber, and grandparents, Reuben and Ferry Van Doren Faber, and Harry and Ida Griffin, a grandson, Travis Welch, a sister, Nadine Squires, and brothers-in-law, Butch Martin and Eddie Squires. I believe we celebrate today a God-blessed life. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Shortly after my grandma died, I was actually asked if I would be willing to share a few things. And I knew if I just got up here not prepared, I would just absolutely freeze and I wouldn't be able to do it. So it's been a busy last few days. So this morning I came here a little bit early and just jotted down some notes. So I will be looking at my paper a lot because I knew that there's no way I'd be able to memorize. I would just absolutely freeze. But most of you here were family with my grandma, so you knew her from that. There's a handful here that were her classmates, and some people here knew her from church, or other people knew her from, as was mentioned in the obituary, she was a school cook for many years, and I mean, people may have had her make cakes for their wedding or their birthdays or even yard sales. I remember grandma was really big into yard sales, and she always had tons of stuff out, and not only would she sell stuff, but she always baked for yard sales. She already had like homemade noodles like made up. They weren't cooked yet, but they were all prepared, and people could buy them frozen. She would make cinnamon rolls or different things, and she'd sell them at yard sales. So I just kind of found it really interesting that she actually died the exact same weekend that Moravia was having their citywide yard sales. But if you knew my grandma, she was not a very affectionate person. She didn't go out of her way to say, I love you a lot. She wasn't like a really mushy person that would give you a lot of hugs or kisses or anything like that. Actually, Grandpa Don and her, I don't know if maybe I've seen them kiss one time in my entire life. I mean, she just was not very affectionate at all. And I can remember being little, I would try to like sit on her lap because she's my grandma and I love her, but I also knew that she wasn't affectionate, and she would like literally push me off. She was not a very affectionate woman. She didn't, but as she got older, I guess she softened up, or she knew that I was going to try it anyway, but she eventually started letting me sit on her lap. And on the slideshow's not going now, but there's actually a picture of me sitting on grandma's lap, and I was an adult at that point, but so I was at least able to prick her heart there a little bit. But even though she wasn't a very affectionate person, and she very rarely would say, I love you, especially on her own, the last few days the last time I was in the hospital with her, I took my mom up there over and over and over. She kept saying, I love you. And it wasn't like I was saying, I love you, and she was returning it. She was saying it first. She said it to mom. She said it to me. Different ones that when she was conscious at the hospital and was able to talk to her, she wanted you to know that she loved you. And this is hard. I'm not even halfway through this. Growing up, I felt like she kind of spoiled me. But she spoiled me with her love without really necessarily saying it. I mean, little things that you might find as like natural, normal, that anybody would do. I just took it as she loved me. I mean, I can remember something simple like being at grandma's house and having the hiccups. And she gave me a glass of water and told me to eat a loaf of bread and it would cure my hiccups. And I took that as a gesture of love, and I still do to this day. I mean, grandma was a school cook, and a lot of the school other cooks knew me just because grandma would talk about me and her grandkids. I can remember at school lunches, they'd have chili and cinnamon rolls, and a lot of times the chili would be really hot, so I'd have to wait a little bit to eat it, but grandma knew that, and she would, while she was serving the food to all the kids at school, she would go back to the freezer and grab an ice cube to put in my chili to cool my chili down because it was too hot for me. And just once again, I just took that as just a sign of her loving me. And I always felt like whenever we were going through getting our food at lunch, she put a little extra food on my plate. I can remember back then, I can't remember if it was like 25 cents or 50 cents you could pay to have seconds, and I didn't have any money. I was just a little elementary kid, but grandma would go back into her purse in the back of the kitchen and get 50 cents, and she'd pay for me to have seconds. And another thing is, me and grandma and grandpa, we swapped houses a few times, mom and dad and us. We'd go back and forth between the country and in town. And I can remember one time, grandma and grandpa were living out in the country, and there wasn't a whole lot to do, so I had my baseball bat and ball, and I was just throwing the ball up and hitting it, playing baseball with myself, and I would hit a foul ball into a bean field or some weeds, and I wouldn't be able to find the ball anywhere. And grandma knew that I'd lost my baseball, and she told me she literally could not sleep at night knowing that I lost my baseball. So she would go out there, dig through the weeds, and grandma was just like me. We just have to look at poison ivy and we get it. We don't even have to touch the stuff. She would get poison ivy super bad, but she would dig through the weeds and get poison ivy because she couldn't sleep knowing that I lost my baseball. And to me, that was just another, without verbally saying she loved me, it was just, I knew that she loved me. Some of you may know that the morning that she fell, it was actually the next morning because she was on the ground for over 24 hours. I was the one that found her, and I didn't know if she was alive or what. I just went into, got to help grandma the best I can, got to find out what was going on. So I called 911, and I was there with her and helped out. And I wasn't worried about mourning so much there because my mindset was, we got to save her. I got to do whatever it takes. Afterwards, after the ambulance took her, then I started crying, but I just wanted to, I was worried about my grandma. And 2 days later, I went up to Des Moines to see her in the hospital. And there she's laying on what eventually turned out to be her deathbed. And she was worried about me. She was so worried that she scared me when I found her. And yes, I was scared, but even in the shape she was in, she was worried about me. I had several people ask me yesterday how I'm doing. And to be honest, I hate it. I absolutely hate it. But I hate it for selfish reasons. I hate it because I miss her. But I say it selfish reasons because even though I'm sad, she's not sad right now because she's with her husband, Grandpa Don. She's with her brother-in-law, Butch. She's with her father, Grandpa Dallas. And just a few days ago, she got to spend Mother's Day with her mother, Grandma Nina. And I know this because Grandma loved the Lord, and so did each of those members, people that I just mentioned. And 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 says that he doesn't want us to grieve like those who have no hope, because if you lived life following Jesus, you are going to get to see them again. And because of the relationship I have with Christ, I know I will get to see Grandma again. Just like Grandma had that hope, and she got to be with Grandpa Don again. She got to be with her parents again. Several other family members who'd gone before, and even friends. So this hope that she had is a reality for her.
holy hills of heaven call me to mansions bright across the sea, where loved ones wait and crowns are given. The hills of home are calling me. I see loved ones over yonder, their tears are gone, and their hearts are free. Then from the throne, Jesus beckons, and the hills of home are calling me. See, this house of flesh is but a prison, bars of bones are holding my soul, but these doors are open when the angel sets my spirit free. Then I'll take my flight like a mighty eagle. Oh, the hills of home are calling me. I'll take my flight like a mighty eagle. Oh, the hills of home are calling me.
I believe I met Nancy January 2015. Met her and Grandpa Don, and I'm from Kentucky, so I never called anybody Grandma or Grandpa until I met those two. And I always liked being around them because he had a really good dry sense of humor, and she would laugh, you know, a cackle. Really loud cackle. So I love being around both of them. Grandpa Don, I can't mention her without mentioning him. One grandpa died before I was born. Another one died when I was a baby. So he was honestly the only grandpa I had. And Grandma Nancy, I had one grandma. She died about 5 years ago. Another one died when I was a kid, so she's a grandma to me. First time I met her, I was gonna walk in their house, and Cassie's very words to me. She said, "Well, my grandma, she's very blunt." And I've always respected her independence, her bluntness, and her stubbornness. I really do. I admired it. Just a super sweet lady. If she knew I liked something and she made it, her words to me were, "I made this, Freddie, you better eat it." I'm gonna tell. I haven't told Cassie this story, They say honest confession is good for the soul, so I'm going to confess something right here. So after COVID, Cassie and I, we were living up here, and so we didn't want Grandma Nancy getting out, going to the grocery store. So I had the daunting task of taking her list and everything she needed done up in Albia to go up there. And so she gave me some checks, gave me her grocery list, detailed instructions for what to do. And man, I was firing on all cylinders. I was getting it done. I was so proud of myself. Found everything on the list. I couldn't find her check. And I thought, how in the world am I going to go back to Moravia and tell Grandma Nancy, I lost check number whatever somewhere up in Albia. And I started panicking. That was 2 years ago, so I'm a 38-year-old man wondering, what am I going to tell Grandma Nancy? I lost her check. And, I think I was in the bread aisle up in Albia. I was like, Lord, I do not want to go to Moravia. I prayed. It is a sincere prayer. I said, Lord, I don't want to go down to Moravia and tell Grandma Nancy I lost her check. And searched my pockets again, pulled up my billfold. I had folded it up and put it in my billfold. So I did not have to tell her I thought I lost her check. That's a burden off of my shoulders today. So, but, you know, like I said, I felt like I fit in with her, and I know it's going to sound strange, but where she wasn't that affectionate, I felt like I fit in with her really well, because that's how my family was. That's how I was raised, and just want you guys to know that Revelation chapter 19 talks about the marriage supper of the Lamb. There's probably going to be chicken and noodles there, all right? Yeah, rolls, and some cinnamon rolls. And when eternity comes, you may hear, hey, I made this for you, you better eat it. You may hear that. And just in appreciation of Nancy Clampy's honesty and her bluntness. And I'm going to be leaving 500 miles south in a few days. I'm going to tell you something right here. Nancy Clampy, she is a sweetheart. She's a super good person. She might not have said, I loved you, but she showed you I loved you. But you know what? Not one of those things gets you in heaven. Not one of those things earn you a spot in eternal bliss. The second greatest preacher, because Jesus was the greatest preacher, the Apostle Paul tells us that we've all sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. You know, there's not one thing we can do to earn our way to heaven. But it's a free gift. And when Tyrell said, we're here, we're not people. The reason we have hope is because of the goodness and mercy of God that was shown to us through Jesus Christ. And by the power of the Holy Spirit, who brought us to new life in Christ and gave us the spirit of adoption. Reason I have hope of seeing her again and hopefully hearing, hey, Freddie, I made this, eat it, is because of the finished work of Jesus Christ on Calvary. And I miss her. I miss hearing her cackle. I miss the bluntness. But it's just a short-lived miss. Grandma Nancy right now, she's in heaven. It's already felt like an eternity to her, probably. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. To live is the Christ. To live is Christ, and to die is even more of Him. And we have hope today. We're mourning because we miss her. We're not mourning because we're never going to see her again. If there's no resurrection, then everything is pointless. I tell you what, just as sure as we're sitting in here today, she's in heaven. And she's in heaven because of Jesus Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit. Lord Jesus, we want to thank you for Grandma Nancy. We want to thank you for the influence she had. And when you think about it, she loved cooking for people. She loved playing games with people. And Lord, that's how she showed her love, by being with you and doing things for you. And Lord, I am so thankful when I think of what she's done for me, what she's done for my family, what she's done for everybody in here, and how she was with us. Lord, that's just the glimmer of who you are, the things you've done for us, the table that you've prepared for us. Lord, your presence being with us. Lord, you created us to be image bearers and to reflect you and to show the world what you like, what you're like. And Lord, Nancy showed that to me by displaying her love to her to me and all of us by what she did and by just being with us. And Lord, I'm thankful that you're like that. You do things for us and you want to be with us. And Lord, I want to thank you for her life. I want to thank you for how it's affected me and affected all of us. Lord, I'm thankful that I'm not standing up here hopeless. Lord, I'm so full of hope this morning to see her again. And Lord, I know sure as I'm standing here, she's in your presence with all those that have gone on before. And Lord, I pray that everything that's done in this funeral, everything that's done today would honor you and glorify you, and Lord, and edify the body of Christ, and that it would bring conviction to those that need you and bring people to repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. Lord, I want to thank you and praise you for who you are, that even in sad times and just in bitter times, because of the goodness of God, there's a sweetness of eternity in there. And there's that hope that we have, that we cling to, that pulls us through. And Lord, we pray all this. We want to tell you we love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Apparently that's on. I got to make some quick notes. Don't let Tyrell go first. Don't let Freddie go next. Trample on my sermon. God, trample on my sermon. Because we're all going to say the same thing, folks. That's how that works. Well, I'm going to give a gift to Nancy Clampy. She loved long sermons. That was preacher humor. I noticed some of you didn't even get it. You were like, oh, no. And some of you, when we're done, you're going to believe it. No, I won't be long, but I've got to give a little bit to Freddie. He said something. He quoted a verse, actually, is what he did, and I didn't have it anywhere. But I'm going to give it to you real quick because this is good. What I am talking about today is the difference between Christians and non-Christians. If you put that on a scale and weigh it out, you can look at people's lives and you can look at the world and you can make all kinds of evaluations. But I'm going to tell you that there's some stark differences between Christians and non-Christians, unbelievers. One of them is at the moment of our death, the solidity of knowing Christ is instant at the moment of our death. Now, you have to define death. I'm not medical, no heartbeat, no brain activity. I don't know the legal definition or the medical definition of death, but God does. And in the moment of death, Freddie quoted a verse that it's 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 8. Verse 7, I'll give it to you real quick too. It says, we walk by faith and not by sight. We walk by faith here and not by sight. And then it says, I am well pleased, yes, rather, to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. So while we are on this earth, we walk by faith and not by sight. But the instant you leave this earth in spirit, you see Jesus instantly. John chapter 14, beginning in verse 1, Jesus said, "Let not your hearts be troubled." That's a pretty good word for us today. Wasn't what God laid on my heart, it's what Freddie laid on my heart, so close. Jesus said, "Let not your hearts be troubled." And so Christians today, you see, are not as troubled. Y'all both trampled me pretty good on that one. Point three later. "Let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God," Jesus talking now, "believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you." Listen now. "And if I go, I will come again to receive you unto myself, so that where I am, there you may be also." Jesus promised to come back for us when we die. So then Paul said that when we die, we see Jesus. Makes perfect sense to me. But that's only for the Christian. That's only for the believer. The non-believer does not have that hope. So when you're dying, when non-Christians are dying, they do anything and everything to stay alive because they know that the moment their eyes close in death, their hopelessness, I'm going to talk about hope, their hopelessness is going to kick in, and they're going to know that their eternity is fixed. You don't want to be a non-Christian. You want to be a Christian. Not a believer in any religion, Christianity. Christianity. You say, "Oh, well, that's pretty inclusive." No, it's exclusive. It is the only way. Because in John chapter 14, I think I did the first three or so verses, but on down there, Jesus said, whither I go, you know, where I'm going, you know, and the way you know. And Thomas saith unto him, "Lord, we don't know where you're going. How can we know the way?" And Jesus saith unto him, "I am the way, the truth, the life. No man comes to the Father but through me." Confucius was confused. Buddha, well, I can't talk about him. I look more like him every day. When I sit down, people confuse me for Buddha. They're not going to get you to heaven. You know what I'm saying? Jesus is the only way. And you say, "Well, I don't believe that." Then throw this book away, because that's what he said. I'm not giving you my opinion today. I'm telling you the Word of God. Well, I'm about to start preaching. That wasn't preaching. That was just encouragement. I got to talk about Nancy very briefly. That was kind of her cackle right there. I can't believe you said the word cackle about a person that's laying here deceased. But that was the right word. If you said something funny, she'd just go and laugh. And it was just that made it funnier, whatever was said. So I love that too. But I wasn't going to do that until you did it, Freddie. So I got to say something else. Some of you have received from Nancy. See, Facebook, you're talking about a deal. Facebook was invented for Nancy Clampy. Hey, how about an amen? Come on. Facebook was made for somebody who liked to write letters. Anybody ever get a letter from Nancy Clampy? Don't raise your hands. I saw arms moving all over the place. Here's the deal. She thought, we talked about this, and she would say sometimes, "I'm going to write them a letter." And she was dead serious when she said it. She thought that if she could formulate her words into a letter that sometimes were blunt, that if you decided to quit reading it, you could put it down. And then your curiosity would make you wonder what she said next, and you would go pick it back up. She banked on that. She knew if she just tried to tell you that you could turn her off and get in an argument or debate or whatever. So she liked writing letters, and then she moved to Facebook, and it was public. Freddie, the Bible says confession is good for the soul, but it doesn't say public confession. So just keep that in mind for future reference. Now, you say, well, what's the point of saying she liked to write letters? She liked to write letters. She liked to try to help people understand why she said what she said. I'm going to give you three words today from the Word of God that all come from Paul's writings. Do you know what we call Paul's writings? Epistles. That's a Greek word, and it means letters. Nancy was in good company. Paul was a letter writer. Nancy was a letter writer. When it,